Last week, we talked about the idea of SpaceX's Starship flying to Europa and Enceladus. And as if those moons weren't fascinating enough, there's one moon that is even more fascinating.
We're of course talking about Saturn's moon, Titan. Why is this moon one of the most fascinating places in the solar system, and why would it be a perfect location for Starship to visit? Well, as always, I would say, let's find out. The outer solar system is a really fascinating place. In the last Friday episode, which you can watch right here, we talked about the icy moons of the outer solar system, specifically Europa and Enceladus, which both have oceans of liquid water underneath their surface, where possibly even life could exist. And while all these moons have either no atmospheres at all, or at best extremely thin ones, there is one moon in the outer solar system that just stands out extremely. This moon of Saturn basically stands out from the rest like a bodybuilder at a conference for theoretical particle physics. We're talking about Titan, of course. Titan, while technically an icy moon, is so different because it's the only moon in the solar system with a dense atmosphere. And we are talking really, really dense here. The surface pressure on the surface of Titan is an astonishing 146.7 kilopascal, so 1.45 atmospheric pressures of Earth at sea level. The atmosphere is composed mainly of nitrogen with 98.4%, the rest being methane and a bit of hydrogen. Titan has a diameter of 5,150 kilometers and is thus the second largest moon in the solar system after Ganymede, and larger than the planet Mercury. But fascinatingly, it is only 40% as massive as Mercury, therefore the surface gravity is surprisingly low, only 0.138 g's or 83.5% moon gravity. This in itself is already extremely interesting. Why? Because this combination of very low gravity and high atmospheric pressure means that we could fly on Titan.
Yes, if we would have wingsuits, we could just fly around on Titan like birds, no joke. This has been wonderfully visualized in the short movie Wanderers by Eric Wernquist, link in the description down below, which we highly recommend you to watch. It's a must watch for every space fan. Okay, but certainly, flying is not the only reason why we should go to Titan, right? No, of course not. Titan has so much more to offer. For example, Titan is the only place in the solar system besides Earth with lakes, rivers, and rain. Yes, it rains on Titan. There's even erosion from rain. There are large river systems, and the largest lake, Kraken Mare, is really ginormous, with a surface area of 400,000 square kilometers. This sea is almost twice as large as all the great North American lakes combined. But we didn't talk about a very interesting detail yet. Titan is cold. Very, very cold. -179.5 degrees Celsius, or 93.7 Kelvin cold. So these lakes and rivers and the precipitation on Titan can obviously not be made out of water. They are in fact made out of liquid methane and ethan. And what is powered by liquid methane? That's right, Starship. To make all this even more insane and fascinating, there are strong indications that Titan, like Europa and Enceladus, has an ocean of liquid water underneath the surface as well. Titan has been extensively probed by the Cassini probe, which arrived at Saturn in the year 2004 and flew by Titan many, many times on its 13-year mission until 2017. With atmosphere-penetrating radar, Cassini made many high-resolution pictures of the lakes and surface features of Titan. And in January 2005, a small probe called Huygens, which was attached to Cassini, even landed on Titan. The pictures of this strange world fascinate many people, including us, to this very day. The probe sat down in a dry riverbed, and you can watch the whole descent from orbit to touchdown. Link to a video in this video's description. Okay, so that is already insane enough. Now it ends, right? Now finally Starship, please. Yes, just one second. There's one last intriguing possibility here. Life. Again, as with Europa and Enceladus, we could have life in the subsurface ocean on Titan. But here probably only microbes, because the tidal heating of Saturn is not as strong. Titan being quite a lot further away from Saturn than Enceladus. And please consider subscribing to our channel, because first, it's completely free. And second, it will tremendously help us to continue talking about such fascinating topics. And third, you can even vote on the topic for the next JS Space Report. We would be extremely thankful for your support.
On the surface, there are many organic compounds which could lead to the development of life in the far future. Now it is too cold on Titan for life as we know it to form on the surface, but when the sun grows larger and more luminous in the far future, Titan will actually become a very nice place and might be an excellent refuge for our extremely far future descendants. So this world is so incredibly fascinating on so many different levels that it's basically impossible to pack it all into a short video. We'd need to make a 2-hour documentary on Titan to fully capture the amazement this moon creates. Now, apart from Starship missions to Titan and the previously mentioned past missions, NASA is planning to send the Dragonfly mission to Titan. Dragonfly is set to arrive on Titan in 2034. Good old conservative NASA timelines. Why not the year 2500? But okay, Dragonfly is essentially a nuclear-powered octocopter drone. The radiothermal generator produces 70 watts of usable power, which will allow the drone to fly with a speed of up to 36 kilometers per hour and 4 kilometers of altitude, and explore many square kilometers of interesting surface features as long as the battery lasts, which normally will be quite a few years.
Other proposed missions, for example, include a submarine that would explore the depths of Kraken Mary. Well, we really hope that we can see this one. Who knows what the submarine might find deep down below the lakes of Titan. And now, of course, finally Starship. In our last week's video, we suggested a stepwise approach to colonize the outer solar system. We said that flying directly to the Saturn system with the current generation Starship would be psychologically almost impossible due to the long travel time of about 7 years. Of course, with giant O'Neill cylinders, our Stanford Taurus type of spaceships, we could travel there. But this is still very much beyond our technological capability to build. So for the time being, we will have to make do with Starship 1.0 or Starship 2.0. In order to get to the Saturn system, first, we will certainly need bases and refueling depot on Mars, in the asteroid belt on Ceres, and then in the Jupiter system on Callisto.
From Callisto, then, we would be able to send starships to the Saturn system. They would arrive at Enceladus and Titan. You can watch our last week's video, link in the description, to find out what they would do on Enceladus. On Titan, the starships that would land would of course also immediately start setting up a base. But contrary to Enceladus, the focus of Titan would first be to construct a giant refueling base. Since we said that Titan has lakes of liquid methane, which is, together with oxygen, the main constituent of Starship's fuel, this of course would be perfect to refuel Starship. We'd basically have an almost infinite supply of Starship fuel. The oxygen we would of course get from drilling holes deep down into the subsurface ocean. We could then get water up to the surface, which is of course always needed by humans. Care should, of course, be taken for eventual microbial life, so you certainly shouldn't just drink that water straight away. it would certainly need to be purified. From the water, we can then extract oxygen, which we of course also need to breathe. But the same oxygen will then be cooled down and liquefied for Starship fuel to power the Raptor engines together with the liquid methane from the Titan lakes.
So Titan really has all the ingredients to extremely easily set up a base there. This moon would really be a wonderful destination, not only to fly around in wingsuits, of which we are sure it will become a total tourist attraction, but no, we will also search for life in the subsurface ocean. We will learn about how methane can shape the surface of our world and how it behaves differently from water. We can even marvel at rainbows, because Titan is, due to precipitation, the only other place in the solar system besides Earth where this beautiful phenomenon occurs. Here at least, due to the thick atmosphere, radiation would not pose a problem anymore. Solar radiation is totally absorbed, and even the high-energy cosmic radiation is almost completely deflected by the thick atmosphere. Of course, the low gravity on Titan still remains a problem, since it's even lower than on Earth's moon, with 0.138 g. So if our future settlers want to live for long periods of time on Titan, rotating underground habitats might be necessary in order to combat bone and muscle loss, or of course with genetic engineering. But these are problems that can be solved. More and more starships would arrive on Titan, and so the bases would also grow. We assume that we will have the first base on Titan around 2050 realistically. If we consider that we need all these other bases on Mars, Ceres, and Callisto before traveling to this distant moon, and from Titan, we would of course expand further and further into the depths of the outer solar system.
From Titan, we could even visit Uranus, and even Neptune and the Kuiper Belt objects. Cliff jumping on Miranda might become a thing. Jumping down the steep cliffs of Verona's Rupes, the highest cliffs in the solar system, with an insane vertical cliff wall of 20 kilometers height. Again, wonderfully visualized in Eric Wernquist's Wanderers. Around Neptune, we could explore the geysers of Triton, another fascinating world. And of course, someday even the heart of Pluto. There are many, many more worlds for us to explore in the future, about which we'll of course all talk in separate episodes. And Titan will enable this. Titan, with its giant lakes, will act as the perfect base in the outer solar system. And who knows, some of our younger viewers who watch this might one day even fly around in wingsuits on this amazing distant world. And if you're interested, if Starship could also fly to the other moons of Jupiter and Saturn, for example Europa and Enceladus, you can watch this video right here.
So don't forget to vote on the topic for the next video. And I would say, on to the future. So for Friday, we do the icy moons, of course, right?
If Starship could also fly to the other moons of the solar system,